Dire team ban. Dire team ban.
Duska.
Dire team pick. Dire team pick.
Naga Siren.
Dire team pick. Siren. Dire team pick. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Reserve time.
Anti-mage. Anti-mage.
Dire team ban. Dire team ban.
Tower and was very efficient. This guy is a serious farm lord, though. He is all about the Diablo kind of a play, just you know, PvEing his way until he's ready to just kind of take a fight. Is it just his young talent thinking outside the box, being very unique with those farming styles? Like, I know you're a big AM player, so what's it like?
Five seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Don't you think there's a bit of risk to it, though, if you're kind of jumping into the unknown, or you just kind of like, there'll be a creep wave there now, jump in, and unfortunately you jump in, there happened to be someone there to catch him or anything, or is it just he just kind of can read the map that well and just knows? Yeah, okay. I mean, he got away with it, so I mean, so far he's been pretty damn good at doing it, so can't fault him on that, but it's a pretty tough test for him now. It's not like it's going to be as lax as it was, where I felt like the teams they had gone against coming up to this match, like the Union Gaming match and stuff, like, he just got away with doing whatever he wanted. There really was no pressure to the anti-mage forcing him to kind of be in an uncomfortable position. He just got to do what he wanted, but I don't think that's going to be the case here going against this highly touted squad.
This anthem is going to be under a lot of pressure, I feel. It's a Naga Darkseer. They're most likely going to be dueling and following the anti-mage around. I wonder what supports Cloud9 is going to pick in order to get this Outer Shell Naga out of the way so anti-mage can farm.
Is it going to be something defensive, like a Wyvern to be picked up, or that Dazzle's been banned out, going from Wayman one of the next best things? Spearbreaker pick for DC, though.
Huh. I don't know. That's a pretty common duel lane, actually. That's three melee heroes. What the hell? And, like, I don't... Naga, Spearbreaker support? I don't know. We'll see. Like, Spearbreaker is really good against Anti-Mage, so...
Is it far out of their realm that what if they're maybe we saw this already from Sector V in the last round where they just lead in with a Naga and end up just transitioning it over into the one Karen? Position Naga.
Yeah, Karen now that sucks asking that way though, so we'll have to see. I don't know, because like sure Anti-Mage is really good against Night Carry. Like back when Night Carry was popular, Anti-Mage is one of the counters. Mm-hmm. But against Spirit Breaker it's very it becomes different. Like the amount of pressure you can apply on Anti-Mage just goes to hell when you're against Spirit Breaker. You can't just do those like wave cutting tricks anymore because he's gonna see you with the charge, and there's gonna be a lot of pressure with the iron shells and stuff. So, let's see. Like Anti-Mage, when you pick Anti-Mage first too, like
yeah, I mean they're putting a lot into Ritsu just getting one of his good comfort heroes here, and. You know, you're picking a dedicated core like that, you're just allowing the other team to really brainstorm any possible way that they can to make sure this anti-mage doesn't get to do anti-mage things. And look how long they're really nursing the clock for their third pick here. Or maybe they already know and they're happy to install it out, but more or less they're probably like, ugh, okay, pressure's coming. How do we deal with it? And what can we do to... Witch Doctor.
They needed Dazzle, but Dazzle got banned, so... Oh, we'll see. This is pretty good. They need defensive support, basically. They need things that... make it so Digital doesn't just run in.
Windranger at your service.
That was a pretty fast Windranger pick. I think they were picking really fast because I think C9 took a long time.
Pick. They know that, yeah. Forcing so them to no,
they
think quick.
They have 52 seconds of reserve time, though. No, they're fine. No.
Well, they probably led into the start opening very fast, I guess, getting that AM and Tusk, but yeah. Well, Windranger quick response here for DC. Well, there's still some other possible options out there for the mid lane. They opt for her over others. I wonder why that is. I mean, you got your Shadow Fiend still out there, your Queen of Paint still out there. Why Windranger over all these other options? Usually Windranger seems like the option to go to if you're kind of running a bit low as far as good potent mid laners. But
I mean, there's not many good mid laners. Yeah, Lina, alright, they're gone, alright. You have, then against good Anti-Mage, you have like Seeker. Or Templar, right, they're both gone.
5 seconds
and then you have Storm
remaining.
Spirits. And I guess they just don't want Storm
Reserve time.
Yeah, it's true. His backlash from that crazy void is not going to do much against the Windranger. And you need that bit of lockdown for someone like AM. If you can maybe get a nicely timed Blink Dagger or something in your Windranger, you can catch him off guard real fast. It's pretty nice. And then the Clockwork response, taking Bulba, using a little bit of what he's got against him. So, they'll be the one to support the Clockwork. I think Bulba played Clockwork every single game that DC's done so far. It feels like it at least, but they got it now. Yeah, it's definitely a great way to just kind of disperse. Vinyl Ban, Cloud9, they get rid of the PL here, anticipating DC to be picking up their farming hero here for TC. Anything standing out to you, EE, as far as a good option here for Digital Chaos? You're going against your AM. You're going to go against a lot of hefty hitters and initiators here between both the Tusk and the Clockwork, so whoever it is needs to be able to kind of step away from trouble in a moment's notice, I'd imagine.
5 seconds remaining.
Oh yeah, Dire Sight Ursa. Yeah.
Reserve time. 5 seconds remaining.
There's definitely gonna be a bit of a clinks. Okay, I haven't seen much of that since you know EG loved to throw it in for fear, but. What is it about a clinks that says we're gonna be running you over them? Is it just the second he starts? That's what I was going to say.
10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Cloud9 will have the final grab here. We anticipate Storm their mid lane hero, and they will be the one to grab the Storm Spirit for Brax. Yeah, I was going to say that Quap's maybe the one other one. And Storm's not the worst thing to be stuck with, and the AM's on your team, so it can't be the worst thing in the world. And they have mediocre lockdown. If Klinks, you know, we've seen different builds from Klinks, from you personally, the Blinks, from Fear and his, you know, Medallion Desolator build up. TC, we'll see what he does. Do you consider going a bit of a throwback and getting like an Orchid on your Klinks or Windranger just to deal with the Storm Spirit? Force him into a Yules or something like that?
Five seconds remaining.
What about now that we see all five picked? So you think once you might have got the draft, C9's commitment early to the AM could feel a bit shaky at the start, but does seem pretty well-rounded when you look at it. A lot of hefty mobility from their side, and a lot of people to really get in the face of DC, but I guess you can almost say the same for DC side.
I think,
you got that Spirit Breaker.
Personally, I like DC's draft more, but I can see C9 get away with things. Like, Clock can do pretty good top, but it might probably won't happen. And then save the Storm mid against Windrunner. Storm mid against Windrunner is actually one of the worst matches for Storm. But Storm, like, if you practice that matchup really well and Storm, like, under good blocks and stuff like that, then you're gonna be fine. Still a really hard matchup to deal with. So on these lanes, because if DC snowball, just they're not gonna have anywhere to farm on C9. I feel.
Bulba also not able to get down there and get that precious offlane ward down, so maybe he'll turn the corner over here and put it in a rune spot instead. But let's go ahead and get things started here. This is Nanyang Championships and a qualifier. We're in the winner bracket finals right now. The winner of this series goes into the grand finals. The loser will have to bop back down to the lower bracket and try to battle their way back into those grand finals for a rematch here. And it is a best of three. We'll see a bit of an early clash from both sides. Cloud9 committing with the coconut, actually catches, three-man bounce. They turn their attention, they want to take out Brax, the mid laner, if possible, but it's Biru who actually is getting the most of the harassment right now and can barely edge away. He's going to be going down. The last slash is SVG, and Owie also going to be in trouble here. Brax still alive, they're going to chase for him, committing now from Yawar. Even the wind run here, they'll be able to take him down. And it's a two-for-one trade already. Advantage for DC. Early bloodshed coming out.
That's freaking big. They had two batting runes as well. MSS didn't try to fight the Klinks top for the rune. That was very disappointing. I don't know if you guys heard me, but I was like, oh, come on, dude. Like, he just ran away from top rune. Let the Klinks get it.
Yeah,
and like, I hate it. I did not like that.
Didn't want to bother. That means TC gets a little bit of a bounty boost. And from what we saw, the breakout there at the bottom lane, Brax goes down early, and you can already see the emphasis of the assistance coming out from C9. Tusk kind of playing like that Earthshaker-esque. You know, he harasses out the mid lane. Now he's going to make a little stack over here. Not your usual spot that we see Tusk nowadays, but he's going to be there to assist Brax, it looks like, for a little bit here. Because as you said, it's a better matchup here for the Windranger, and Yawar walking already in with one kill certainly is going to make things a bit easier, I'd imagine. But he will have to use his salve, and he's going to be left with one shared Tango. We'll have to get that boot, or that bottle, rather. I'm sure at a moment's notice here. Well, what's happening bottom? Ooh, Iron Shell City right here. Ritsu has to juggle these Iron Shells quite a bit, but it looks like Teban's gonna just try to zone him back. So they're doing a dual lane
Ritsu
here.
Ritsu is actually so freaking good at Dota.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, he has ACS out of 8.
Even through the juggling Iron Shell and against the dual lane, he still finds a way to get in there and get every last hit.
Yeah, Tuskar wasn't there either, so it was tourist too. I'm impressed. Yeah, it's 5-9 as well.
Steps back, is gonna get a little.
I wasn't watching him though. I was watching him. I'm actually only watching.
Well, that's just how it goes. You can't keep an eye on all three lanes.
Dude, this guy's good too. Like, this guy's laning.
Oh,
he's fucking good.
That's a little shackle and a power shot harassment. I don't think Brax will be going down, or will he? Look at this. You are committing for it.
Fight,
he's gonna get it. One more auto attack. Gets the extra vision just in case from the charge, and Noir, two straight grabs onto Brax right now. And as Tusk tried to come in to help out, he's gonna get acknowledged right there from Biru on the Spirit Breaker, and. Well, nothing will be had. 3-1 now for DC.
Alright. Somehow Ritsu has he has good CS, but I don't think Anti-Mage can bring you back into this game though. Like, it's gonna be Anti-Mage isn't one of those heroes that just so single-handedly wins you the game. And like, unless he has like a really fast battle for you, but I think he's gonna have like a fast stretch or something, but then the game's already gonna kind of fall apart from there.
We'll have to see if that's gonna be the case or not. You can see the early inklings of it right now with already the hefty advantage DC have been given at this point. And we already know what Aoi can do on this Naga. He's trying to keep MSS zoned back as much as possible. Definitely not letting him even consider pulling out that side camp right now. Back at bottom, still they continue to harass him a bit. Roots at 17 and 6. TC matching him on CS, now up to 18 on that Clink. So both core safe laners really getting a lot, even with the bit of harassment coming their way, especially on bottom. That dual lane still being here. Looks like Biru is going to venture out on the side. And they walk away. They have a double stack here just in case the lane gets too far forward. I guess Demon can always pull back that double stack on the bottom, but doesn't feel necessary for now. And how are we doing back in mid?
The thing of Spirit Breaker is like when you're getting anti-mage on lane, if anti-mage is able to hit you a few times, you don't have mana to charge anymore.
Yeah, 100 mana. And he can't even charge twice as it is with a full mana pool, so life is hard when you get smacked. And he'll have to just wait out what looks like for the 4-minute rune. Maybe it'll be a regen for him. Will Ice Frog be nice? We'll have to see. He'll wait it. Or at least maybe could be guarding it out. No, Yawar's gonna go for top, so runes both sides. It's actually gonna be a DD there at the bottom, leaving the bounty at the top, which Aoi is gonna certainly assist with. And it looks like he'll make his way back top.
They have a lot of early game control. They're able to get every rune. Just from a lot of pressure they're putting on the map. This Spirit Breaker, he's part of the DD rune, has. He ain't got that mana.
Well, now he's thinking about making him go towards mid lane, but top lane, we see a bit of a skirmish here. MSS goes toe-to-toe with Aoi and gets the help from Tusk. They snowball four, and they're going to get the kill on the Naga, but TC could get him. MSS not going to grab him. The salve's going to be there, and they will be able to step back. Cloud9.
That word mid-season, so.
You're certainly right, and now we'll see him charging in, and it's going to be very quickly canceled. They really want to see if they can get this Storm before he gets to his level 6, but I don't think it's going to be happening here.
Good recovering by Storm Spirits. Like he's doing pretty bad still, but not getting shut down as far as, like, Yor only has a few CS over him.
And now he sees Steven here.
He's way higher level than him,
so. Yeah, holy shit. Don't even think about staying and playing. Yor pulls him back and decide to step back and away here, but look at this, suddenly Ritsu is alone in this bottom lane. Only has to deal with a couple of iron shells, but he will be able to continue farming up, and is going right for the ring of health right now. So we'll see if he decides to commit, go for some boots, some power treads, or if he's going to be all in on this early battle fury.
I heard Ritsu only plays Antimated off, so...
I have heard from their coach Lumdun, he feels like Ritsu's best hero is actually Ember Spirit. Yeah.
He plays three heroes. He plays PL, Ember, Antimage.
I don't think we have yet to see him play Ember in any of these matches yet. No Nanyang matches yet.
Yeah, he's probably just lying to everyone, so everyone thinks he can play more than one hero. But he doesn't Antimage.
I mean, is it going to actually get to a point, let's say C9 keeps succeeding and doing well with Ritsu's AM? Is it become almost first fan worthy? I mean, you risk giving up a lot then. If they're actually going to be considering picking it up in first phase, maybe for some of these teams, they might need to consider first phase banning it. But you don't want to have to do that, because then something like a Lesh or something will get through. It's scary. Bounty Hunter. Tusk. Who knows?
It's good that they're living in a lot of pressure top, because now this Clink can't just move away and let AUI free from. AUI can't really do anything against those two heroes.
Alright, looks like we'll need a second here, at least for the side of the Digital Chaos group. What do you think about the name Digital Chaos, Envy? How would you rate it? I asked Merlin the same question. On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being like the most badass name you've ever heard, 1 being something else.
Give it like 0.6.
0.6? Alright. Something.
Yeah. C9 definitely has a better name here.
Yeah, I'm not gonna lie, Cloud9's pretty legit for a name. But you get DCT Steve now. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's pretty... no, that's not cool at all, but I like that.
The DCTC right now, Clinks.
I would definitely change my name if I was DC. To like, DC Tyler Cook now, or something like that.
Yeah, Troll Chief. This was originally was for TC, but yeah, also Tyler Cook.
Really?
Yeah, that's what Grant said, at least, back in Dota 1. It was the Troll Chief. I think I even have a signature I made for him back when he was known as Troll Chief too. But we'll see. DCTC flies off the tongue, I guess, for now. We'll see if his performance goes with the name or not.
These winners, Elu's got a creep, what? He stole one of the creeps in this deck. I don't know how many he stole, actually.
I mean, he could definitely scatter with the illusion, even send a power shot that way if he wanted to snag some side camps. I don't see Wind Rangers really do that at all. That seems just an inefficient use of power shot if you're in the mid lane like this and you're able to just quickly shoot over to this side camp here and efficiently farm it on the side, or does that just seem a bit ridiculous?
Well, his hard camp?
Yeah, from mid lane, like where you are.
He doesn't really have the mana for it.
Dyer's meanwhile, bottom lane, Spiritbreaker going to be going down. A trade from both sides, one for one. It's going to be Clockwork going down for the Spiritbreaker here.
It's about 5 kill for level 3 kill. But Buryu is really sad right now because now he's lost a lot of experience.
Yeah, he's still level 3. He's going to make his charge back to bottom lane to get there, and I think it was something we were talking about before, at least the last time I catch a Digital Chaos. Aoi being the one who always seems to find that farm, or at least some XP. He's actually getting really close to his level 6 for a Naga at this point. Does always a good job pulling the camps and finding some solo XP, working with those. TC to get his solo XP in the lane and farm, and he's going to get really close to that Naga song. What about Bulba? What's he been up to? He's got a soul ring, so he jungle farmed a little bit, it looks like. But he's going to find his way here. Maybe head back towards the bottom. Oh, here we go. Biru makes a charge onto Ritsu here, and a very nice Shackle follow-up. Even the ensnare, Ritsu will be going down. He will not be able to blink away. And it's now going to be a killing spree for Yuar on his Windranger. At the same moment, top lane, they're making it go onto TC here. They got the dust. He's able to get the kill onto Clockwork, and he will not be going down. He will walk away. Back-to-back takedowns of MSS in this top lane. That's two kills across the board for DC.
Well, Windranger is going Orchids. Alright.
Aha, it took my advice. Well, yes. Yes.
No, not Clink's Windranger.
I said either. Come on.
Do you really?
I said Clink's at first, or maybe the Windranger. Check the tapes. But no, it is definitely a bit unusual for Windranger as of recent. And
I mean, that is unusual, but have you clicked on anti-mage?
Yes. Don't want to allow.
Click him. Click him.
Oh, what?
Click him, dude.
Oh.
What's happening?
He is adventuring away, starting to go for the blast.
I think what he did was, I don't know though, I haven't turned back, but I can't turn back time, but I feel like he had the blast on quick play, but then because he was blind, he just bought it.
Oh.
I still think he's going Battle Spring. If that's the case, that might be pretty legit actually, but yeah.
He's halfway between a couple items though. Did decide to commit, finish out this treads, but yeah, he's just going to be holding the Hedras for now. It's not going to help him a lot in the damage department, at least for now, so he'll just jungle farm. It looks like this gives some solo farm time for Thieben, who actually is already level 6, nearly level 7 on this Witch Doctor. Last time we saw him play this Witch Doctor in the last series, maybe it was just the circumstance of the game being pretty lopsided, actually put pretty much no points into the W or the E of his Witch Doctor, just 1 point into Voodoo Restoration, and then he went all stats after maxing out the stun. So maybe it was just
it's kind of hard for him to run to melee range against those heroes. Like, if you run in, you're gonna die to Clink's stuff. But what's really important right now is, Spiritbreaker is finally getting levels mid, because Spiritbreaker is one of your biggest counters to anti-mage, so you really want to give him stuff. And because his Rain Ranger is so farmed, he's just sitting bottom, and he's making his anti-mage not farm there anymore, basically. But, I mean, he's just pressuring bottom. But the thing is, like, anti-mage doesn't care. Like, he can farm jungle, like, no problem. Honestly.
So he'll do that. MSS left that top lane. He's now level 6 on this Clockwork, so it looks like he wants to hope for something to come his way for a big hookshot catch. Brax has been persistent, now has the top CS in the game at 86-3 on his Storm.
Yeah, he's been doing a really good job catching up, honestly.
Very dedicated to staying in this mid lane and farming his way
back. I think
he got
a lot of small gold, so it's probably a little bit more than people think. He's still been doing pretty good.
Bloodstone to be wagered. It looks like he already had the Arcane Boots and the Soul Ring, so seems to be the first grab for him, but he will be stalked here. Illusion sees him. There's a charge already out.
They might be ready for us, though. There's a clock there. Yeah, they actually stop. DC's actually playing very patient there, because Clink's had no creep, so he's very weak. And now Clink's blocked his own camp, so that sucks.
Got a little too close there at the end. Doesn't want to have to go for a golem.
DC's playing very safe and patient.
Okay, they know that he's not seen here. Do they have enough? They do. Big shackle. Quick death pack, quick kill. Brax gonna be going down there. They made that one look really easy. patiently waited out for an opportunity, and it was granted to them.
Very good word by, he's scouting a lot of movements.
Ritsu takes his business to the top lane, where he will be welcomed by Owie and a charge that's en route from Biru. We'll see if they look to follow it up with anything. MSS is coming up there, so he could wait behind Ritsu here. And they could get a counterplay. They actually see the charge. They have that very deep ward. So he all actually quickly backs up. And I guess they didn't want to even try doing any sort of counterplay, so he'll walk back and away. It's been a, you know, for a game that has a Tusk and a Clockwork on the same team that are now both level 6, they're not really finding opportunities. Bottom lane, though, Braxis, he's looking to make a go into Bulba here. Jumps on in with the help of the Death Ward and quickly pops the mech. Looking to make a run. Surge is going to expire. Follow from MSS, he makes the party. And we'll jump in with the hookshot, but it looks like Demon will go down. Yes, he will. Last little searing arrow, but TC could pay for it with his life. They have the dust. They're going to pop it. They were not able to get off the walrus punch yet, though. They're not going to be able to chase him. Oh, man. Oh, they'll walk away. So it's going to be a Bulba Darkseer for the Demon Witch Doctor.
I think they should have killed him there with a faster dust. I feel like it was a miscommunication where they kind of like didn't know who should activate the dust because they both had dust. But I feel like in a situation like that, you just freaking pop that dust. Like, both of you just pop it as fast as possible. And because they actually might have got killed. They have four heroes there.
Too nervous to let go too much glitter, I guess. So because the kill's going to be getting away. Oh, Biru shows up in the mid lane. The second Teemin pops in, gives him a little welcome coconut. Force him back out. Very hesitant here. So they rotate back and around. Brax back at 1,000 gold, still on his catch-up game here. Got a lot of farm for a Storm Spirit who doesn't even have a kill yet. 0-3, but he's still trying to make his way into the game. An SVG on the Tusk. Oh, he's not able to get in here.
Bye-bye. Spirit Breaker first Anti-Mage. Dire's bottom tower is under attack. Clockwork misses hook mid.
So they're not going to be able to get the jump, and they will lose their precious Ritsu.
I think it's very good that they didn't. They missed the hook there. I think if they hit that hook, they might have lost the game. Because I think Bo would TP in and heal him, and then they'll be the death.
Yep. Bobo still has that wall ready to go, and even a mech, if he was to show up, they would probably have not even gotten the UR, but they are going to get this tier 1. First tower of the game going to be rocked down there for DC.
If I say things like that though, it probably means like, it's not good, you know? If I say like, you should miss the hook because otherwise you're going to beat your whole team to death, you're looking quite bad.
Now we patiently waiting in this top lane here. Giving Ritsu a bit of a work here with just the illusions, but they know this. They ping out exactly where Owie is. Maybe just figuring he could be there. No, Ritsu is just like, he is there. The hookshot will see it. Owie's like, oh, I might need to go here. Has
Why
a TP.
Why for us?
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
I don't think they're going to be flying in. And yeah, they would have the sleep and they have a tier 1 tower Radiant for help. And while they're dealing with top lane, Yawar has a DD rune and he is just going to start Radiant's focus firing down this mid-tier 1. And there will be no Radiant's response. It'll be a free and easy tower for him. We already know he has his Orchid now and 700 gold to boot.
Goodbye, Witch Doctor.
He goes down there mid lane, quick and easy kill. And it's a mega kill for TC, so Digital Chaos, they came in this matchup. Favorites, according to Dota 2 Lounge. Plenty of favorites right now.
Are they going to defend top tower now, or are they going to get Roshan now? Because they have the ability to do either one.
I would say the Roche seems a bit more tempting.
I think they should defend. Like, Ranger wants to go, Roche, but... Nah, fuck that. They should really defend. They have an Orchids now, it's a surprise Orchids. They have a Desolator and stuff for Roshan.
Yeah, if they can...
I think they should take the fight, though. I don't think they should look for Roshan right now. Don't give them anything, just make them cry.
Well, they're taking your advice. They have all started migrating up here, so they look like they're going to be ready to play.
Yara is just waiting bottom though, trying to get a kill. Like, because if they all go top, then one guy's in the TV bottom, like that, and then he can get a pickup. Trying to do, I think.
T-Bin's down there for now, and it looks like C9 are just not going to press the issue here at the top lane, and they're going to step back and away. So they're out.
They're going to go for mid instead.
And it looks like it could be on Ritsu. The charge is already out. Well, goes right to the mid lane, but Brax is there. Charge is still coming. Hookshot's going to miss from MSS, so they go forward onto Ritsu. Shackle connection. He goes down so fast. Spiritbreaker? Long Nether Strike. Gonna get the catch. Storm Spirit's gonna get bashed as well. Able to Bolt Lightning. Quick Ole on forward.
Oh my gosh, 17% actually like made them miss the kill because he missed the power shot because of it. For once, 17% not good.
Bash, that's not going to actually work out to the favor of DC. My god. Brax is going to be able to live on. They just orchid him. Ooh, Shackle not going to hook off to that direction. Goes to the back creep instead. But all the while, I mean, TC gets free poke damage onto this tier 2. And they're going to grab it. Oh, not. Brax gets a deny. But that's more map control for them, and they could beeline it back to the Roche, possibly.
I think they should wait for sleep before they get the Roshan. DC's a very calm team, it seems, which is very, very good for, that's actually very good to have. They don't seem to take any risks that are not calculated.
Especially in the America Dota scene, having a team that can be patient, I think is probably very, very rare to come by. So,
DC, though, he doesn't care about that sleep, man. He wants to... those points, those solo Roshan points, so, alright.
It's scouted, TC.
Alright, can you just get the sleep, dude? Can you... I mean, can you come on, dude? I've been here before, dude. Like, not good. Alright, whatever.
Well, he's got help now. It looks like they will be able to get it down quick. Mid lane, Brax, though, is making a jump for Aoi. Not gonna be able to get it. Yiru shows up instead, and... they're just diverting their attention elsewhere. C9 knew the Roche was going down. Not they're going to be responding to it, but they have smoked. Now, the thing about a setup onto Brax, but...
Orchid. They're going to Orchid him.
They Orchid. Bye, buddy. Will he be able to follow it up? Yep, he's not able to come away, but look at MSS. Big jump in for him, and a big cock catch on the two. Follow-up, big snowball, big uppercut. There's Momo, though. Huge vacuum into the wall. Now they're going to look for Teban here. But hey, look, Brax is back. He's able to move in, and he gets the kill onto your Spirit Breaker. A one-for-one trade now. Aoi barely extra alive, able to waltz away from this one. Brax has some mana. He's going to retreat out. They see Teban here. He's trying to TP. Oh! Shackle on route is not going to catch him and follow him instead all the way back to the base.
If I was DC right now, I would definitely report Bola. Like, what the hell was that? he used wall and vacuum or something. That's not good.
Yeah, that's right. That boosted mana cost for mech. Even for someone like a Darkseer, it's going to just cost him so much and miscalculated.
Whatever.
Not going to have the
mech. That, right, that was kind of the best fight that C9 could hope for. And they couldn't do it, so... and they can't really still push their way back into the game. But even though we're still have a battle right now, like, you can't outskill the enemy. Like, you can't outskill a Spirit Breaker, you know? Spirit Breaker can outskill you with, like, his bashes and stuff, but, like, you can't outskill shit.
We'll see. Maybe...
I actually don't know. Like, they're gonna need to win some fights with buyback on Storm, I guess? Something like that. Not easy though, because even if you were to speed a fight and get the buyback off and stuff, and you get the Witch Doctor going and everything, because they have a sleep, AEI, like, there's a lot of things that need to happen in order for you to find yourself in a game-winning situation, or a situation where you can turn the game around.
I feel like there should be some opportunities though. I mean, is it best to wait for that sleep to be on cooldown, then you can... try to formulate something to make it go in there? They still have about
But the problem is, like, if Klinx or Windrunner is next to you when you're trying to make a gank attempt, then both of them can kill you. And Spirit Breaker can get always the charge, and then there's a 4 staff and a mech from the other guy, and there's a sleep. So it's very hard to find yourself in a situation where you're gonna get a pick for free, and it's very hard to find yourself in a situation where you can fight these heroes that are very tanky. And the only hero that's not tanky is Windrunner. But even then, like, it's rough.
Yeah, and she has Windrun, though, to fall back on as well. It'd be a bit hard to grab a hold of her. They smoke, they move bottom. Well, C9 put their attention more towards the top. Does just feel like, in the meantime, DC are going to be controlling most of this map. Radiant's bottom as Brax will have to wait out on the bottom. Looks like they want to see if they can get some quick damage on this tower. 13 seconds, sleep will be back, so even if they try to come down here and make a play, they will have the sleep ready to go. For C9 though, I mean, they've only taken the one tower, they're still trying to at least get another tier 1 underway at this top lane, but it ain't gonna come easy. Look who's already rotating in, Bulba's first. And they just see him and they're like, I don't feel comfortable anymore.
They if they go back. On him, Naga can TP and sweep him, so it's actually... I'm not sure what you want to grab, sir, to win, because you can't sneak Roshan, there's no... There's not much you can do, really. They have two smokes, so might as well burn them as well. Might as well burn your smokes.
Yeah. Ooh, TC spots Brax here. That prompts an immediate charge from Biru. TC will wait. But here comes everyone else. That means the Orchid's here. Brax is like, I don't even want to bother. Just offs himself. And we'll head back to base. His new Bloodstone charges, and V now getting down to 5. Not looking so good.
I mean, this game is looking basically impossible. I think. It's like, there's a Sector V game where DC was up 20,000 gold at around this point. But even in that game, there was a mess at this point. Wow, this one is rough.
Well, TC did walk himself into a bit of trouble here, passing that sentry, and they will be able to get him, but you are from the low ground doing some good work. MSS could go down here. Biru looking to commit, trying to get the nether strike. Not gonna happen. MSS turns onto him, gets the hook shot off, and will finish him off. Yawar. Sleeping away, gets trapped with the shards. Look at that! For a game that seems impossible, Cloud9 are able to get at least 2 kills here, Envy, so...
Who got the kills, sir? That was extremely bad play by DC, but it's good. They got 2 kills. The reason why it was bad play is because all the lanes are pushing in. Like, the top lane, bottom lane, and mid lane are pushing in, so in that situation, all you need to do is wait and just be chill.
Mm-hmm.
But it's actually kind of rare for TC to make that mistake. He's a very safe and somewhat calm player, and they're a very calm team it seems so far, so I was actually surprised they did something like that, but it's kind of whatever.
Oh,
like, so.
Demon's dead. Yawar with the back end of what looked like a DD room was able to easily finish him off, just gets the quick catch, quick kill, just showing that even for the little support, nowhere's really safe to move out there and find your own bit of farm. Brax will come across though, a nice little regen room for himself, and just start putting himself into the DC woods, a safe spot for him to farm up in the meantime. TC will be nearby. TC is holding on to 3,200 gold here, Envy. What is the... Is he finishing out the Solar Crest? What's the big item for him that he's been holding on to here?
I would have liked for him to get Solar Crest, but I have no idea. Probably gonna get BKB or something.
Now even a big stack to add to that ridiculous amount of farm. The fire is way through that.
What C9 needs right now is, I mean, Storm Buyback is one thing, but the other thing is the magical Anti-Mage ulti on the Windrunner when she has very low mana. I think that can also, or Darkseer. If you get one of those, because no one has a BKB on DC, it's actually fairly easy to get something like that off. That ulti could change the game. Because all they really need to do is, it's very hard for them to win that one teamfight, but if they do win that one teamfight, they do have an Anti-Mage, they do have a Storm Spirit, and these two heroes are like some of the most disgusting heroes you can have if they're farmed. But they do have that.
The dream is there. I mean, if the stars do align and he gets that huge mana void off, that could definitely be C9's jump into a huge fight here. Now they are starting to... Hear your advice, Envy. They use the first smoke, at least for now. So they venture off towards the bottom lane. Their target...
Got the jump. If they got this jump.
If they can get Aoi before a song, that would be ideal.
AI is playing safe.
We'll see, it's all illusions. No smoke popping yet. You're going to walk right past them, but Aoi's safe as ever. Way already out in the front door of his own base. So this smoke is not going to be getting anything right now for Cloud9, unfortunately for them.
The weird thing about general. Dota is, like, when you make a play like that, or where TC runs up the ramp and dies, like that might save you from losing. Like, that might save DC from losing, in a sense. Because it's not big enough a mistake to cost them the game, or to cost them map control, and it makes you play safer. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, in a lot of pubs, like, generally, there's a lot of pros. If your first pro is, like, one kill, then it might not be enough. Everyone just starts playing safer,
yeah.
But if your first throw is a 5-man kill from Zoltan and Tyre, then all of a sudden the game is like they caught on, you know?
Yeah. That TC catch was like a slap on the wrist, so they could shake that off and go. But oh, they do get a shackle, not gonna latch for SVG, but they have the fault nether strike and then the bump after. I mean, it's just ridiculous. He just can't do anything. He's just sitting there just getting bombarded with damage, and the Tusk is gonna be going down.
Yeah.
Quick movement here from DC.
He's going Hex on Quinksor. Or Lincoln's, but I think it's gonna be axed. It's going for more solo kills. I actually don't like this item choice. I don't think they need that in this game. I mean, it's for it's so the they don't have orchids anymore for Anti-Mage because he has a mantle. So, like, I guess it's for that. Personally, I prefer solo quest into BKB, something more safe. I can totally see it working.
We'll see what kind of use he's gonna use of this. I would wager probably towards the side of a sheep stick if he has to commit first.
It's just another item that makes you have high mana. You know, it's another thing that gives you a chance of getting blown up.
Yeah, being that nuclear bomb for C9. Yeah.
Coming that miracle that Ritsu is looking for. That is what you're investing your gold into, potentially. Or it could be really good, obviously. But for me, it's a little risky. I personally think Evasion is very good against Storm Spirit and Anti-Mage. You know, they're not two heroes that go MKB, and every hit they do, it matters so much.
Oh, look at this. Cloud9 looking to inch on forward here. They drop a ward, it gets pinged immediately inside DC. And they'll step back instead. Alright, so we know for C9 what would be just kind of the dream, the miracle kind of a play for them. DC could play the safe and continue to just not allow them to get that kind of opportunity. It feels like they're just for now waiting out for this Roche. Fortunately, we don't know the timer properly. I'm sure it's bugged for you as well, but I can't see what this clock freaking says. I imagine it's probably going to be up.
For Roche?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's bugged.
Well, he doesn't.
It should be very, very soon.
Ages had already expired,
and
so.
If that Roche ends up, they can. And what matters is insta death.
Yep, they already have Yawar there to kind of scout it out. Biru's doing his own pressure.
He's going Lickin' Sphere on Atomage again. He did it last time. But this time he's doing it again against Birdbreaker, I guess. Or the Hex by Klinks. Actually, might be a really good item choice. It doesn't really work against Klinks though, because if Klinks finds you, he's going to get charged, and then that's going to break the Lincoln.
Yeah, that's a global Lincoln's pop right there.
I don't know. I don't know. I don't like it. It's not the miracle item like that you need. Like, because Lincoln's is like kind of a safe item. I don't like it, actually. I think it's better to go for something like Dire's top tower. Something more crazy. That's like a butterfly.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. With the farm TC has, he would be far away from bothering with anything like an MKB. So. Can foresee the evasion being very, very useful, but
it's good against everyone. It's good against like even like a spirit breaker. That could be huge.
Well, he's gonna charge forward though with this ulti orb. We'll have to see if it's gonna be that miracle item for him. He'll just continue to farm up and play his game. Bulba stepped off for he's got a four staff and a blink dagger now, so there can't be any way he will not get the perfect vacuum all with so much mobility, I'd imagine. We'll have to see. We'll pressure out this top lane a bit towards Risu's side. Just feels like DC are waiting. Roche is up now, so they can get some wards down, have the coverage. Right. They have one up over here, it looks like.
It's a BKB on Storm Spirit. He can maybe go for the Roche on steel.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's a bit of a scary lineup to go against. You got both a Storm and a Clock on the side of C9.
But they have a sleep, though, because there's a BKB. We'll have to see.
I don't know, have they seen the BKB yet? I guess he has been in lane. If they did clip him, they would have known. Alright, well, Cloud9.
They only like 10 seconds to that Roshan, though. They have a D-Ring, they have a Quinks. Sweet. Honestly, that Roshan dies so freaking fast. Radiant's top tower
is under attack. But how disastrous would it be if they moved in there and couldn't get it done in 10 seconds? It does jump in, he does get the steal, gets out with his life.
Yeah.
That would be heartbreaking.
I feel like what DC is going to do right now is they're going to pressure top, and the very moment someone TP's top, everyone's going to run into the Radiant Jungle to control that area, and then they're going to get the Roshan after it. That's what they're looking to do right now. They're just trying to force someone to TP top. If no one TP top, then DC just keeps freaking farming until someone TP's freaking top.
It's like a mini game of chicken. Who's going to abort and try to go back and stop the push and allow the Roche to open up or not? I mean, C9's already moving that way a bit. But the Lincoln's was pushed.
On him.
Oh, Lincoln's is online and ready. Mid lane showing it off. It looks like DC will just farm up the ancient camp and continue to kind of hang around and loiter this Roche area until they want to go in. If this is the jungle move to get some wards down, we'll see. Nope, Owie just kind of scouting it out for now.
Alright, so they see people top now. And what to see people tell, I wonder. I think they're gonna start running into the enemy jungle and start taking control of that area, because that's the most important area right now because of Roshan being alive.
There they are.
They see Anti-Mage top as well, so they're just gonna go for Roshan, I think. Just kill it in like 2 seconds and a half. Goodbye. Goodbye,
move
Roshan.
In.
Yeah, that's true. That.
And
so that was a good strategy. They executed it correctly.
Good split pressure coming out from DC forces Cloud9 to have to abort the idea of doing anything with that Roche pit, and that means that the Digital Chaos crew is going to be able to snag that extra life. So now Digital Chaos have the Aegis. Took quite the tactical approach to have to even just get the Aegis, but now that they have it, Envy, what do they need to do? Is it now that all the ammunition that they need to just kind of move forward and take tier 2s?
No. You just chill out. You see if the enemy is going to be getting mistakes first for the first 2 minutes. Because when you get something as big as an Aegis, the enemy plays differently all of a sudden. Because they expect you to push. So they start like split pushing. They start trying to make it so that when if you try to push, they can do something for it. They start forming more aggressively. Something like that. So you just wait a minute. See what they do. React. And then if they don't do anything, then that's when you get the tier 2 top.
Okay. You can see bits of that already happening now. Ritsu utilizing that Manta to pressure out that top lane, which DC quickly get on. Then he flies on through to the mid lane.
I mean, I guess they're just pushing. They're both showing top.
Yeah, we'll see. Maybe if they come all the way in from the north. Maybe they feel comfortable trying to take a fight at this point. Don't want to risk that AM farming away. I mean, he already has 3k gold saved up now on top of the Lincolns, which was his last investment.
Wonder if Ritz is gonna get the guitar or try to. It's freaking hard though.
Here comes the top tier 2. It's gonna be dropped here. Focus fire coming out from Yawar. Magnum's in hand. Actually, good damage.
They're just gonna go base. He's gonna get the guitar on Ritz.
Yep.
They have buyback on everyone on Radiance. Totally. Yeah, they actually have buyback on everyone. Clockwork.
Well, here they come.
We'll see.
They're inching in. The glyph is already popped. Ritsu makes his return back into the base. The two archers just continue to pelt this tier 3 from the low ground, especially War. They'll finish it off. Are they going to be content with just that there?
Well, Ritsu has no buyback, actually. He needs a kill or two.
You're right. Only 1k gold. He's a bit short.
I think they're going to keep going, but we'll see.
So what did he invest in? Oh, he's got the Basher now, yeah. Basher in hand. They'll see that.
They're gonna wait for TC's BKB. In base. I like this play more. I don't like it when they keep going. And that's generally not the... That tower is hard to kill. I mean, that ramp is hard to kill. The ramp is so small.
The
Radiant ramps are in general are very small. In comparison to Dire. Except the bottom ramp. That ramp's huge.
Is that something that's still transitioned over from Source 1, or is that something new from Reborn?
I think this is Dota.
It is pretty damn big. Here they come though, mid lane. Let's see if they can get the tier 3 or poke it a bit now. TC has that BKB, fresh 10 seconds in his inventory now. And the Radiant are just going to be holding their buybacks because they feel like they'll probably need them here if they want to hold off this push. Split.
They just have to be careful how they kill this force because he does have buyback.
Oh, big force forward on UR. Now he does have the Aegis here. They're going to commit the Wallace Punch and they're not going to go for much more than that. Oh, what a jackal. He'll connect on the MSS. Big vacuum wall follow-up. There's going to be the Greaves thereafter as they continue to run forward. Big snowball to get out from trouble here. Biru's going to be eating the coconut. No one to go down as of yet. Keaton's going to unleash the Death Warden, take out the Spearbreaker, who will immediately buyback. Now they're going to commit to go on his TC. Uppercut him. He's out. He didn't get the buyback or the BKB. But he does go down regardless, and one by one they begin to crumble. Cloud9 able to grab on. Nice hookshot follow-up, roll forward, and it looks like Yawar will be next as he's trapped inside the cogs. It's going to be four down all day, including the first life of the Spirit Breaker. Now it's just the one Aegis. Not much you can do to get away from this. There's going to be the Vortex pull, and he's done for. That is a five-man wipe.
That's
counting the first
huge
life of Biru. That is a one hell of a hold coming out from Cloud9. They only lose their Tusk. No additional
towers. That was
actually so big. That looked like it started so well. They got in there, a big vacuum ball with a snowball out, or some sort of repositioning.
Was that the reason, though? like for me, like I mean he's a TI winner, but what the fuck does that leave? I'm so confused right now. Like I don't understand. Was it a misclick? It might have been a misclick because it's next to Riptide, which is your most used skill. But I feel like if you misclick that sleep or whatever, you just get out. Because what about that sleep? You don't have a get out of jail card. Is under attack. You need it for sure. Mm-hmm. Like even if you kill them, they all have buyback, so you need that. You need it to get away. But instead, they just blow the sleep, and now that was so big. Actually, like losing a fight like that. But all of a sudden, they're actually down in experience, and now Goat is within 4.5k.
Put C9 back into even if not
they're
better position, yeah.
Straight up back in the game, like that's straight up back in.
That is a butterfly nearly complete now for Ritsu as he just grabs the talisman right now. And this AM will be quickly six slotted once the Abyssal's done and perhaps some bots thereafter. Things get a bit scary here for DC. Her song is still online now, but oh man.
I wonder how hard is it to kill this guy when he has a butterfly.
Well, let's see. Spearbreaker goes in, is lucky to get off a couple of hits and bash this follow-up with anything. TC on his clinks, no MKB or any way to work through it unless he can get the sheep off, but that doesn't block the evasion anymore, if I'm not mistaken. That had been changed.
They're gonna go again. Because they still have the Aegis, and they're gonna bank on this Aegis. But they... Once again, they have this buyback ability now. And Ritsu didn't have buyback last fight, but now he does. And now everyone does.
We'll see what happens here.
I don't think they want to overcommit too
much.
No,
they're not gonna push.
No, they don't have that extra life.
I don't think it's good either. I don't think they can push anymore. I said this game was looking impossible, but they actually found a way to come back.
It just seems like what players like to do when they cast and watch games, or even if I'm watching and watch games from behind the scenes, is, oh, it's over. It's over. It's impossible. There's no way. But I guess if it was everything achieved perfectly, yeah, maybe yeah, there's no maybe. Way to win. But there can be those user errors, a misslip of a button, a bad sleep here, a surprising item grab there. Just can be a chain reaction of problems. Might have been the case here for DC to lose that big push.
Yep.
Now we see a game where things are back square even, if not possibly even a bit better for Cloud9 as they etch their way up this top lane. They're eyeballing this tier 2. They're going to have Ritsu stay in the lane and maybe see if they can have anyone come by and get baited. But most of DC are dealing with this bottom lane here. Do they need to kind of just continue to play this slow from the side of DC until maybe the next Roche and try to get that again? It feels like Cloud9 by their body language. It's like, we're not afraid to cross the river now and go out on our own. That probably gave them a big boost of confidence with that big hold, and it looks like they're just ready to now play a game of Dota. Top tower is under attack.
They should get their butterfly on Ritsu before they do Kalkio, I think. He already has it. And he still has buyback after it. So they should not fight yet until they have it.
It's on the route.
There's not gonna be a fight until he has it. Once he has a butterfly, it's rough. They need to... Now DC needs to get their MKB, basically. Because Wolf MKBs, they still kill him in 1 second, but Wolf MKBs, it takes forever.
How far off are they from it? We look at TC, he's got about 2k gold for it. You look at War, and yeah, he's got some serious money. You know, 3,800.
Oh, well, he knows he's in this.
There he goes. Rex is gone. Uses all the remaining bits of his mana to make it all the way out of that top lane position and away from trouble. He's up to 13 charges. Remember we were talking about he was down quite a bit. What, 5? 4 charges? No. Cool. It's got them all back.
Yeah. That's a lot of charges.
He's farmed. Yeah.
He's looking good. This, Anti-Mage is the most farmed hero on the map now by a lot.
Oh, yeah.
A lot less.
Nearly 8k. Ahead of the next closest, which is your war on
once once the MKBs are online, what happens is everyone able to one-shot each other, basically. Like, you can kill this Anti-Mage if you get him in sheep and stuff. Or stunned. But if he jumps you episode, he also kills you in 1 second. That sort of thing.
It's a big if,
they
though.
Sleep, though.
If they get a hold of him. He holds the Lincolns and all the support behind him.
So basically, it's become a game of true skill.
Yeah.
Whereas before, it was more of a game of tactics when you're ahead.
C9 not looking too put pressure elsewhere, and look who's back up.
This Roshan.
Roche is up, and C9 are close.
Oh, yeah, they absolutely cannot give this Aegis to Storm. So once again, they're doing the same playstyle. Yeah, Boba just pushing on top with Lanchos and trying to force someone to go back.
Which he did. SVG's there first, and Brax is behind him.
And if they are able to get everyone in there, they can kill this Roshan once again in 2 seconds. With the Solar Crest and Medallion combo. Same. And with the sleep, they should be able to get this and run away.
They're moving in now, they're gonna get the tackle. Bottom lane though, they're gonna catch out Biru, but he's just kind of there to make the bit of space and divert their attention elsewhere because...
Yeah, that was completely fine by Biru, it's not that big a deal anymore because they're already caught up in gold. His kill is kind of whatever. Now, Anti-Mage just looked at this level's Moonshard, then he's basically maxed. The level 2 trials.
So I'm at my final form.
Yeah, a level 2 trials with Storm Spirit is actually pretty hilarious.
Yeah, you're right.
You can do a lot of
TP, and then he jumps in. Jumps in, sudden mana void there to follow, who knows. But he's getting there. The critical mass is coming, and so is Yawar's MKB.
He has it. Yeah. He needs some. I wonder what they're gonna do now. Are they gonna wait for the MKB on Clinks? Because. I mean, Clinks right now looks like. Kind of looks like a piece of shit right now, that's how it feels. Like, Desolator isn't really necessarily that good anymore on his on the hero. And Sheepstick isn't really what he's looking for, because there's too many Lincolns on the other team. And there's a BKB on Storm as well. And it's kind of really hard to Lincoln this Anti-Mage. I mean, Sheep this Anti-Mage. But that Sheepstick is looking really bad on him. He doesn't look very strong, like, basically. He looks very weak.
Just doesn't seem to be as much of a threat when you compare him and put him together with someone like this Windranger and what she's already got. But you can't forget about him enough where you just kind of sleep on him, because if TC does get himself in a good spot, he will do some serious work.
Maybe last fight they might have slept the Anti-Mage so they didn't get a wall on him. No, that doesn't make sense either. They already walled the... They already used wall. If they get a wall on the Anti-Mage, he freaking...
Oh yeah.
He hurts. They don't have any AoE, really. Like, they have a Battle for a Cleave, I guess. But they don't have much AoE. They have a Wishwalker ulti, I guess? Something like that. But yeah, it could totally be possible that they don't notice this Elu just beating down everyone.
Well, so it's something that C9 do consider here for the sake of C9 fans as they farm their way through the bottom part of the jungle, and it looks like DC are gonna go back towards the top. We saw
He sold his Basher. He's going for MKB instead. He's trusting that his team can hook him or grab him. Because he doesn't... Like, he has a BKB, but you can still hook him and stuff. You can still initiate on him. And he's just gonna blink in and burst him. He's not gonna be the one that this looks. Or he's gonna Raper, but I don't think so.
Whatever he needs to get, he needs to farm it fast, and then also have enough of a reserve, I assume, for the buyback, just in case. But it doesn't look like DC are gonna be pressuring the top lane like they did the last time. It looks like they're just gonna pressure a little bit, and then decide to pull back. They could be waiting for the MKB, and there it is now. TC's got it.
Their Aegis, it's gonna run out in like 2-3 minutes, so... This is one of those things where you have to decide, like, do you play a game of Dota, or do you push their base, like... Do you want to prolong the game? And just keep trying to see who fucks up first? Or do you bring it to them? Because it's a very tough decision to make, honestly.
Do you think that a lot of it just comes down to whoever the shot caller may be, whether it's the majority of the team or a single individual? Being able to test their patience. Like, you're playing a long game like this, and you're continuously farming, hoping that you're at the point you're ready to go. It's like, is it now the time? You're questioning yourself, and it's like, we gotta push, we gotta do something.
It's something that your captain will decide, but, kind of. But in reality, it's mostly up to your core. It's like, how confident does your core feel about the situation? Because if your core calls, you push, like, then you're gonna go, I think. But if your core sounds like a bitch, it might change the way you look into things.
Well, unfortunately for DC, both their cores are very quiet players, so I don't know if they sound much at all, but...
If they should... I don't know.
Here they smoke.
Do you want to use the Aegis for a fight instead?
Let's see if they can get their fight as they start charging on in, C9. Already all five towards this mid lane. They're just like, they're out there somewhere in the dark. We don't want to go out that front door.
The Storm is at a point in time where even if you have the sleep, Like, if his BKB is off, you can't really get out. If he has his Vortex and stuff, like, he's gonna kill one of you. And he has a zip that's long enough for him to find you, even if you sleep and run away. And and not everyone has a TP scroll this late into the game, because there's too many items on every hero. Like, Yorah doesn't have a TP scroll anymore.
C9 kind of second-guessing where they want to go with this smoke here. They anticipated that possibly DC were near their ancient camp, which they were. But they can't quite commit to either going up or over here. I mean, I guess you move inch by inch to see if maybe your smoke just slow, like, begins to expire, and then take advantage of that moment, but that's not the case.
I think it's actually very different style, EG sort of style, where DC's playing right now. This takes a lot of balls to have, like, to make this decision. Most people, once they get that Aegis, it's go time. Like, they will go. If they lose that fight, then it's like, oh, you know, whatever, we had Aegis, we had to take a fight, we have to take a fight, we had Aegis, sort of mentality. But they're actually playing safe, they're playing calm, they're going for a late game, they're believing in themselves to play the late game. And so it's not very easy to do that, honestly. Very, very hard, especially in pubs. Like, how many pubs would you get an Aegis and you would tell your team to not push and they're like, no, I'm Aegis, guys.
I'm immortal, I'm going in.
We have to push, Aegis is running out.
Well, they acknowledge that they're not going to get much done with that. They just stay back, continue to farm. All that meanwhile, Cloud9 did go and use two smokes all day. Did not find anything with them either way, but they did plant some pretty damn deep wards here throughout DC's jungle here. Could prove to be pretty helpful if they keep this push back and DC decide to disperse and go back to farming. They might be able to catch someone out with that extra bit of vision, but might not be too easy. DC could just hold shop inside the C9 woods here if they want to. That's just very tough to go. It's been like 3 kills in the past 10 minutes. This is where you know both teams are just lots of respect for each other and showing some discipline.
So what happens as this game progresses is because... Oh, there's one Aethos, alright. I don't know if I like that, but because of the game state, like, these supports, they can't form on their own. They have to kind of camp their course. And you can't really, like, just go like, alright, oh, which doctor, you farm this lane, you know? That doesn't happen, because these guys don't push out the wave fast enough. You need the pressure, or else you lose too much map control. So, anti-mage is basically gonna be farming, and Storm is basically gonna be farming. And this anti-mage is gonna be maxed soon.
Yeah.
And he's not gonna get any more items, but he's not gonna give farm to his teammates, even if he's maxed up, because he has no time. He has to push out these waves. It's gonna be very rare that, like, Witch Doctor with his jump, right, bottom lane, is gonna have the balls to push this. Because, you're not gonna find that many opportunities, basically, so he will max out, whereas the core's on...
He just got an AC, too.
He can replace his Orchids, he can replace his, get a Moonshard or a Windrunner. He went AC instead of Butterfly. So, I mean, he can do that. He's rich. Might as well. He's also gonna start buying the wards and stuff for his team, so supports don't have to do that anymore.
No, for sure. I mean, now he's... Unless he's playing on replacing anything else, just a boot to travel 2 away from being totally maxed.
But my point is, though, on the other side, like, so Storm's gonna be getting farmed, and then the supports are gonna be farming very slowly. But on the other side, you have Naga, you have Darkseer, like, these guys are gonna be farming. So they're gonna get farmed with these heroes. The only hero that's not gonna be farming anything is gonna be Spirit Bird. So that's sort of maybe what their mentality is going to the late game, that anti-mage is gonna be maxed. If they don't win the game with anti-mage being maxed, then no one else on their team is gonna farm fast enough for us to give a shit about. Mm-hmm. Like, we're gonna have our other items faster. Except Storm. He's fine. But that's... Yeah, we'll see.
But if C9 do feel like there's a little bit of a power advantage for them while this AM is maxed out, they better make a fight happen. They don't want to risk waiting too long and having most of the Digital Chaos crew being farmed up and just kind of overpowering your team as a whole.
He does have a Moonshard to go.
Yeah, you're right.
But look at the way they're playing, like, no one's getting really, like, everyone just farming the anti-mage, anti-mage just farming everything. Except Storm, of course.
He's farming and there's like a Kunga line of people following him. Just like, in his wake of farm, taking little scraps that they can. DC side, they float around the Roche pit, anticipating that he might be back very soon. And they would love to get that Aegis once more.
The game's gotten to the point, though, where this Aegis, like, Storm gets his Aegis, you're buff, but it's very hard for them to get. They don't kill Roshan nearly as fast as BC, and BC has 2. And if BC gets the Aegis, it's kind of like whatever. So they don't have the room for it anymore.
So it's near Rosh time. We saw it the last 2 times, where Bulba goes top lane and pushes it in. It looks like C9 are like, let's just get this lane way pushed out. And then head towards the Rosh area.
Yeah.
But then they might just pressure bottom. Look where Bulba's now. He's going to go bottom and pressure there instead. And force C9
that's
right
not
there.
The same, though.
It's close,
because
though.
If they push out bottom, then they can just easily run into Roshan.
Yep.
Whereas the other way is not the same. When, when you're top, you're literally in the opposite side of the map. It's actually the furthest position you can possibly be from the Roshan area, except like your base. I mean, your fountain.
They're heading up there now. Looks like they want to get that lane pushed back the other way.
So I wonder what Yara is going to get next. This is very important.
I think
he's going to get more damage. I think he's gonna get Barisa.
I was gonna say, like a Daedalus, yeah. Good old Barisa, man.
So is Orchids. You gotta stick to your roots.
The Diablo roots, way old roots thing. Yeah.
Well, so, like last time, the top lane is not pushed out, you pointed out. That's very. But you know, eventually it will be.
Eventually. We don't know how giving this timer is. Actually, it's Roshan's up now. So it's not.
It's already up.
Yeah, so.
So there's actually one more item he can pick up except level 2 travels. Oh no, he already has Moonshard. Okay, never mind. He has Moonshard. I thought he was gonna not play with boots, which is another option he has. That's like the final option he has. He has level 2 travels. He can drop his Lincolns as well.
Oh, he just went in. He's like, my Roshan now does not give a hoot about anyone else.
But do they know?
I'm looking at their vision.
Yeah, actually.
They do. They just put Illusion in there. They know for sure. He popped out.
Alright. They weakened it. They're not really in a position where they're gonna sneak to Roshan and run away. Like, DC can't just, like, use sleep, kill Roshan and run away. I think they're gonna get caught if they do that in a really bad position. So, they're not gonna do that.
This is such a tense game.
They have to.
Jesus Christ.
They have to wait for top, basically.
Yeah.
They have to wait for top. Top's getting there eventually.
Look at all these range creeps. Yeah, it's definitely moving.
But, I don't like this Anthem showing mid right now, though. I think. I don't like that. I think
look at that. The second you said it, they see it, and they take Roche, and they're like, going now! Oh, that might have been it. That's the window.
Yeah.
And as you see, it's a very small window, but that's all they need to fly through it.
Yeah.
And Roche is down suddenly.
Well, I mean, whatever. The thing of Aegis is like, if you get Aegis on Storm or Anti-Mage, then you're looking happy, because you can just drop the Travels for it, you can drop the Lincolns for it, and you're good to go. You can also drop the whatever for it on Storm, like whatever. Like TP, Treads. Doesn't matter, and it's like pretty game breaking if you have Aegis in that. God, I mean I understand. 5 minutes.
So bathroom, but, possibly.
The other way is like if you get Aegis on Windrunner though, like who gives a shit? Like, so it's not that big a deal. See, this Aegis is basically just removing the item slot from him. Like he has 6.2k gold, he's not gonna be able to use it now. But this anime showing mid like that, I did not like that. It's very hard to decide what to do. What you can do is you can just shoot rockets there or something like that.
Yeah.
Like and you just have to use Sigil to scout or storm, cause zip in, zip out, something like that. Zip in a little bit, zip out. He has enough mana to sustain something like that. They need to think of these ideas of how to next time how they're gonna. Like, secure his Aegis, because if Anti-Mage is the one that does this, he can't do that. Like, he needs level 2 travels, then he can top, kill the wave, and instantly TP back, but it has to be, like, within a split second.
Yeah. Fortune doesn't work out this run like that. DC acknowledge and see that the AM is not going to be much of a threat. They move in, they do get their Roche, and we already know Yuar is going to be the one to take it here. He's worried about 6k before he decides to make an investment. I don't know if he's going to just decide to hold it till the Aegis is gone. But we'll see if they decide to just kind of continue to slow play this a bit. But it's going to get to that firecracker kind of a point where shit's going to break out. I'm going to just have to let Jesus take the wheel, and it's going to get a bit crazy. Especially if the pressure's going to go back towards the C9 side, and they have buybacks ready to go, a secondary jump in from Brax and company. It's just one of those things that shit's going to hit the fan. And I can't imagine as a player, like, when things break out that much, that you can stay composed to make sure you get the right target with such and such skill, or lead in and get the quick save with this one. I'm sure mistakes will be had, but we'll have to see what kind of pressure is going to be there. taking a bit of a moment here. 55 minutes. This is just game number one of this best of three. I feel like we're casting like the grand finals at this point. Both these teams taking this very serious. I'm sure there's a lot of eyes out there watching. I mean, a lot of people know EG as the notoriously the big boys on the NA Dota block, but a lot of these other teams are making a name for themselves now and trying to be the team to look out for thereafter. And I think both these teams know that they are those two teams, and the winner of this is going to make a pretty damn big impact. But they're both playing very well.
The way Dota is right now is like, so this at the first, everyone's ending the game in like 10 minutes when this patch first started coming, like a summit 2 or summit 3, summit 3. But because there are solo quests and like Glimmer Cape, they nerfed Glimmer Cape, but that didn't matter. You know, the game was still ending really quick. But then people start to try to find ways to defend. They're like, okay, our base is dying every fucking game. How the fuck do we defend our freaking base? So they start picking heroes like Storm and like Rocket Flare. Like people start like leveling up Rocket Flare. They have Puskar to like throw shards from afar. They have these heroes that
Winter Wyvern shards, or whatever, like Rubik.
Like all these heroes just shoot you from afar. And now like these games are they're not ending, and all these heroes also have the ability to buy back. He's really good late game too, so he makes you want to push. You fucking can, so like,
so are you one of the players? I think I asked this to someone else as well, that think that Storm Spirit might get a little bit of love from Ice Frog, and by love I mean a bit of a nerf in the upcoming patch. Storm Spirit.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't really care. Anyway. I usually just I don't think about these things.
I
could totally see that happening, obviously. It's being played a lot. You can also just nerf like Bloodstone or something like that.
That's true. An indirect nerf. Kind of similar like what we saw. Tidehunter was a hero once at one point. Fresher got nerfed quite a bit. And various other things, and the game changed a lot. No more about offlaners moving to the jungle and having big ults for big team fights. Just the game changes, and that's the beauty of Dota, I guess you could say. But here we go. DC toying with the idea of crossing the river now into the big and mighty C9 squad. You get ready to get to that hour crest mark. Ritsu's got those bots too now, Envy. He's got the bots too. He is at critical mass. Unless he's deciding to replace anything.
He has 855 CS. And now it's getting to the point where his CS is gonna be in relevance. He's marked.
So is it more lane? Mid lane, they find a chance to go on Yawar and rid of the Aegis, and they do it quick. There's the Sawn, but it comes a bit too late now. Is it enough of a setup here to take advantage? Yeah, they're thinking about it here.
Don't like the sleep.
They don't like it. So sleep is down. C9 saying, let's go in. Here's going to be forced to pop BKB. MSS gets a nice two-man catch with the cogs. A roll on forward. A back. You pull back with Teemin. With the Death Ward in a fantastic spot. Starts slaughtering through all of them. It's going to be a triple kill for him. Brax gets a kill himself. Four go down all day on the side of Dota. I almost call them the Dota Simina boys, but 2-for-4 trade. Yawar gets caught, they have to song to try to get him out to safety, and C9, which we already know how mobile they are, they just quickly pounce and they don't get far.
No, I think they were going to let him die. That wasn't the issue, but I think he wants to sleep so that when he revives they can fight, but that sleep was not good. They can't, I don't feel like they can ever use sleep offensively. They need that sleep to readjust the positioning. Like, if Wishcracker throws ulti, then you sleep or something like that, and you get the wall. Dire's structures
are fortified. Well, without the sleep, oh, that Wishcracker ult is in a wonderful spot. Fulba's waiting. He's got everything. Lincoln's up, Brax pop, same with Ritsu.
They need the wall to activate. And they're just gonna back. Alright. So, what actually happened there? I'm not sure. Like, the Witch Doctor got a lot of farm. Antimage got a lot of farm. That actually doesn't matter in any whatsoever.
No.
The Storm got a lot of farm.
Yeah, Brax.
And Witch Doctor got a lot of farm. Those are our two heroes that got a lot of farm.
Brax has freaking 7k gold. Yeah, he's loaded up right now. 18 charges on his stone, and BKB actually has only been used once. So, he's still got full 9 seconds on his BKB. But definitely has room to grow here. Looks like he just made a purchase. What's coming? Someone's got a relic.
I'm a little worried out right now. I don't Metals by AUI, and I don't like his sleeps. I think he should have went Blink or Lotars or something like that, and... Like... Because sleep... With his item build, sleep is basically gonna... Like, he needs to stay alive and fight because he has the slow crest and Velette. But other than that, he's basically just asleep. And I think... Yeah. I don't know why he went with Etos, so that kind of confuses me. Because... I don't think it's good against any of the heroes on the enemy side. He's not good against Witch Doctor, he just ultis you. He's not good against Clock, he's not good against Storm, he's not good against Anti-Mage. I don't think he's good against Tusker either.
Maybe he's just using it as a long-range Lincoln's Popper.
Oh! But... Yeah, that's right. You know, I mean, that's it. That's what. God damn. That has to be it. There's actually no other reason.
I mean, the range is ridiculous, but it's quite the investment to simply pop a Lincoln's, but maybe they just don't have that many options to get a hold of the Lincoln's and pop it. Otherwise...
That has to be it, though, because AUI is really smart with his item choices. He actually understands a lot of things about the game. That's more like... knowledge-based, so that has to be why. I actually don't see any item that's like that. Maybe yours, but that's too close range.
But then it becomes, is the payoff for something like that better than the items like you were suggesting, where he could put himself maybe in a better, quicker position for a more effective song?
But if he wants to play like that, though, he wants to Atos into Brick Lincoln, then he can't sleep to initiate, 100%. He needs to break, get jumped, and then he needs to sleep to save after the jump. Because their heroes have to commit, all their heroes have to commit. And he needs to get them out of there when they commit all of their heroes.
He's trading out the Battle Fury right now for an Abyssal. Pops it down, puts it on the Doom, and now he moves in. Starts chunking away. The first Lincoln's going to be popped. The second one's going to be taken. That means the Ensnare can follow up. And now, TC tries to get the right click. Braxton's going to jump onto him, but that means the BKBs are going to be popped, and they're just going to step out. Let the BKBs go. And look at that. The Rax is already gone. Man, he chunked that down real fast. And now DC have no BKBs. Do you have a song? Do you have a wall? Maybe not for much longer. Bulba gets to get caught, but there's going to be the song. This one will save him.
Are they going to wall?
I don't think they're going to use it to fight, though.
It's a level 16 sleep, so it's going to come back in a minute. Those BKBs aren't going
to... He's trying to get a hook, but he's only level 13. Clockwork's not even level 16 yet, so he can't get in there. Oh, there's going to be a committed jump on Spirit Breaker. They push him back. Now he goes for the Rax. The Rax is going to be going down while Brax is like, look at me! I'm jumping in! I'm going for TC. What are you going to do about it? Vacuum? Oh, Ritsu not caught in. It goes to the other side now. Pushes attention onto Yawar. Looking to muscle him back, but they put all of their focus onto him. So he's going to be going down. Quick catch for that. Looks like SBC is going to be going down thereafter. Brax down and below. It looks like now it's going to be C9 who are going to be forced to retreat. Could not get deep enough and in a good position to use that team fight. Oh, they caught Teban. Even through the Glimmer, they're going to take him down. That means a gem is going to be hitting the deck.
And this means a buyback. So they're going to have a buyback advantage on DC. No, Winner doesn't have a buyback. If he dies, he won't have a buyback for a while. 2 minutes and a half. But I think they're gonna try to get this buyback. Touché. Like from Anti-Mage.
Oh, of course. Yeah. They have a full minute to try to do it here.
Can they do that though? Can they push?
They're running. They are trucking there. Charging.
Let's see what the Storm does. If Storm drops his treads right now and buys the TP, push might not happen at all. Yeah, he's gonna drop his treads. He's gonna get TP destroyed. He's gonna kill this wave. I mean. Let's go. Go for it, dude.
Go. I'll follow him for
gonna,
it. Ready?
He's gonna get both waves. If he's fast. He needs to be faster than this. The wave's getting too close.
Here he goes!
I think the wave got too close. I think he can keep going. But no, they're not going to. I don't even think they can win the fight. Oh, there's catapults. Alright, never mind. Fucking catapults. I'm so cool.
Too bad about your back door, buddy. Oh, the catapults will go down quick. Buyback from Teban. Looks like Ritsu will be able to hold his 18 seconds.
They have a sleep. They need to man up here. They need to... Fucking tower. They can't do this. They have sleep. They have
there
to man
go.
Up.
Glyph is popped. Yeah, they're not going to be able to man up. They can't do it. They got to pull away. They're too scared. Ritsu's going to be back soon, and they don't like that. They got to go.
No, they definitely get the
tower. Ooh, Roche is up, though. Can they creep in and do Roche real quick on the way out?
They probably can, but I don't think they are in the state of mind to realize this.
Yeah, now he's not even going over scouting it.
They definitely could have, though. I don't think C9 would be able to do anything to stop it. They're definitely not in the right state of mind right now to do something like that.
Things potentially feeling like a bit of a disarray here for Digital Chaos while Cloud9 don't lose much. And look at... Ritsu knows what's on his mind. I'm going for Roche. Goes right in there. Now he's going to get scouted from the illusion, but I don't think DC have the time to try to formulate some sort of way to get over there. They do have that
song.
They
don't kill it that fast.
But do they kill it fast enough? Cowie's on route. They smoke. They're going to try to get there a bit faster. It's getting pretty low. They pop out the song. It's coming. No PKP is going to be popped. But it will go down. It will be picked up. Keevan's going to grab it. Now Brax decides to go in. We're on the low ground. Yawar looking to right-click and annihilate the Witch Doctor. Rid of the Death Ward if possible. We've got the Glimmer, and they can't see him. Now Brax puts his head onto Yawar. We're going to pull him back and look to take him down. AM's in big trouble from TC. He goes down. TC catches him. A double kill for TC. Two different fights breaking out. Now the remainder of C9, think about maybe going in, but...
I think he bought back because he thinks Moonrunner doesn't have a buyback, but he's wrong about
he's
that.
He's in here now.
Because if he dies now, it's like... I mean, he's third fighting. He's probably going to defend alone. Whoa!
What a game.
If that damage dies, he has no buyback. Pushing in. They don't care. I think they're yoling this. They're even going to attack top rack. I don't like this play, honestly, but let's see. I actually despise this play.
At least for now, it forces out the buyback from Yawar. It looks like maybe that's all they really wanted.
Right. One for one, I guess.
And they run away.
I actually don't know what's happening, don't I? And I was actually... The game is actually becoming really weird. Like, I think everyone starting to lose focus of the ideas of Dota. Because in fight, Storm got picked up the Aegis. Or Antimage picked up the Aegis by dropping his level 2 Trials, or whatever. Like, the fight would be different. Invisibility. Instead, they will get the same number of kills, and they will force buyback, so will Antimage even dying. But instead, Witch Doctor picked up Aegis plus Sheets, because they're not in the right state of mind.
I mean, can you really blame a lot of people? How often are players, like...
No, I'm not blaming them. I'm just saying, this is what's happening.
It's just like, you do your scrims, and you play, you know, hundreds of games. How many of them are you going to be put into a situation like this, where you're getting 70 minutes and you're forced into a... Is this the right buyback right now and here to end this game, or did I buy back into our own demise? And you can't simulate that. You can 1v1 mids and practice CS games all you want, and but this is where it's the toughest test right
now. Yeah, this is definitely hard. You don't get scrims like this. Maybe one in 100 games, because what happens in scrims is like people don't try hard enough. So once a team falls apart, they just lose. They just sort of give up.
These teams are trying really hard. This is game one. We need to get a win here.
This is probably this is about the number 2 spot in NA.
Without a question.
It's also about the... You just formed the team, so you want your team to succeed. And so he's going hard now. What did he replace? He replaces Lincoln's Prep. He's going to have a lot more HP than he is with Lincoln's. I got to say though, the way he itemizes, I feel like he's mostly correct all the time. And he's very fast devoted, so I'm actually very impressed about that.
He's quick to adapt, goes in, sees what might have went wrong in the last fight, and this time it was I was not beefy enough. And now he's got the heart. Can't ask for anything better to beef it up. And the pressure's gonna be coming in the top lane here.
Right, so DC. If Antimage dies, he doesn't have buyback. Dire's top tower is there's an Aegis on Witch Doctor. That might come into play, it probably won't. Witch Doctor, Aegis, look at me go!
Just dangle him in the front. Maybe they'll use spells on him and take him out. I don't think that's happening. Dire's top tower has fallen. Tier 3 goes down.
Here's a blink down on AI. He has buyback. He has buyback on Clinks. Yora's gonna feel a little safe because he has no buyback, but he's pretty tanky.
Very touchy here. Number 2. Gonna begin the extra
level. Doesn't hurt that much, honestly.
Let's see how these even just the Mantle Illusions here, just trying to chip away what they can in the slow siege game. Drop a ward, lose a ward. Guard goes out onto Steven, still has the Aegis, commits the BKB, everyone all over the place. Now MSS interjects right in the middle of him, separates him back and away, commitment on UR, but the vacuum pullback where they try to lock him down with the Abyssal Blade, decides to stay alive, puts his head to Ritsu! Barely alive, still holding on there, right in the middle, he makes it away! Slips out from Rumble, right under their nose, is going to make it away back into safety. Firu focuses down Brax, they want their attention on him, and there's going to be the song to cancel out that Death Ward. They're looking out, seeing where Ritsu could be. He's healing up slowly in the back line. And there's the jump in. This is going to be all without Yawar out on the sidelines. Over 100 seconds without a buyback here. And now Brax Moves in for Bulba, not going to give him. SBC trading it up with TC. TC's easily going to clear him down. Another vacuum through the wall. TC now dishing out the hefty right click. He does go down. He's going to be forced to buy back here. Bulba etches away. Brax very, very low on mana here. But Ritsu, the important damage dealer, he's still alive, and he's going to start chopping down the racks.
This game is over. Lose him. It seems like... No, he has a buyback on points if he dies, I think.
If he dies...
No, he doesn't. Yeah, buyback on... Naga, he has 4 more speed to go. 1 more buyback on Darkstar.
I don't think that's going to be enough.
I don't think he's going to be able to defend this.
C9's going right for the jugglers. The final hurrah is Emesis is going to make the go into Aoi. Aoi getting bumped back and away. 5 seconds for Song.
Ritsu's dead.
Ritsu does get taken apart. Brax is moving in. He wants to get a hold of TC here to sleep. Oh, no, not happening.
Go, but it's not happening. He can't do it.
He also had the Greaves. It just doesn't matter. The song's going to come out now after the buyback. Okay, SVG and Brax.
Right in the middle.
Brax tried to jump out the back of the way, but he actually going to be going for TC with the snowball, with the uppercut. Do they have the burst? Vacuum pulls him out away from the cogs, but Brax is still going toe to toe with TC, and he's out. That's no buyback. 2 minutes, he's going to be out of the picture. And they're still going on forward. Long jump in from Brax. Doing this all without Ritsu. Biru, Aoi gonna get pulled back. That's gonna be his dieback if he goes down. Valiant Ghost Scepter, Bulba still out on the side. No Surge is gonna be there to help him get away from trouble. And now it's gonna be the Throne in trouble. C9 are going right for it. Biru doing what he can to charge in and slow them down. There's a big Shackle. Yawar's back. He gets a big crush, takes down MSS. Power shot on through, but the snowball's there. Now puts his attention onto Brax. Brax has got the pull. Goes back for Bulba. Bulba barely alive. Limit onto Brax to keep him in a bit of a safe spot. Decides to change targets, jump over. MSS moves in, tries to hold Yawar. They're able to finish off and take down Biru. Now they put the focus back on Yawar. He's going to be going down. TC back, but it doesn't matter. Bulba makes his way to the base, but the game is already called. What a ridiculous long-winded end of this long, tense fight. A game we rarely will ever see in American Dota. These two teams showing that they are on a whole other level and very hungry to take that second position right next to EG.
God damn.
What a ridiculous game.
Like, Storm was just farming Blitzen charges. He actually had 3 lives at the end. He had 27 Blitzen charges and he could have died. He could have had another buyback. And he actually has enough mana to zip there. And I gotta say, this Ritsu, like...